So I hope you had a good weekend. I know I did, so I might need some help from you with some questions along the way. Please come in, get seated. So, who here recognizes this figure on the very first slide today? Does it mean anything to anyone? I see a finger.
Is it a pointy?
Sorry, can you speak up a little?
Is it several pointy?
Correct. So this is five different protein sequences. What did we do with these sequences? Yes. So we have aligned these, and I already heard the word homology. Very good. So what about these sequences would tell us that this is a homolog? Do we know what is a homolog? So a careful finger there.
I was going to say the alignment of certain amino acids at the same position to tell it's a homolog.
Right. So can anyone give me the definition of homology? You're very close, but you can phrase it more specific. Yes.
Sharing close ancestry.
Right. So what type of ancestry?
Shared parent or shared homestead.
Right. So a homolog, by definition, is something that shares evolutionary ancestry with its homolog. So what tells us that these sequences might be homologous?
Similarity.
Can you say that? Very good. So which of these sequences do you think are and are not homologs anymore? Are they all? Are only the top two? This gets
stripped. Mean, at least the four and the dot R, probably. Like DTX.
Probably. So by eye, you look at the sequences of these four proteins, and you guess that they are similar enough to assume that at a recent point in time they shared evolutionary ancestry. Alright. So, very good. Good start. We'll get back to how similar these are in a second. First, a couple of important announcements. So for the master students in the room, make sure that you are registered for biosystems data analysis for period 3. This is at the UVA, and we have historically had some issues with people not being registered at both universities or not being able to register for both courses. So please be on time to make sure that you are indeed checked in before the deadline. Second, very importantly, there's about 120 of you and only about 6, 7, 8 of us, and we haven't had time to learn all your names yet. So please, very soon, add a profile picture to your Canvas account. This helps us figure out who you are and find you more quickly if you need help with anything. And perhaps the most important announcement of today is set up forwarding of your VU email. All the important communication that we need to send to you goes through your VU email accounts. So if this is not read regularly, or if this is not read or forwarded to an inbox that you check regularly, this will be problematic. So make sure that you do this. You will be reminded of this very often. I hope by now the reminders are no longer necessary, but just for the all of you that haven't forwarded yet, make sure this happens. Okay. So, this slide is a very brief and very top-level overview of what you will be doing for your projects. So you will have a small sequence database. On these sequences, you will perform BLAST and PsyBLAST, which are algorithms that we'll explain towards the tail end of this lecture. And you will compare the predictions or the outputs of these programs with one of three reference databases. So for the master students, you have been assigned one of these three databases. The people doing principles of bioinformatics will all be working with the genealogy. In this comparison, you will try to answer the question, which of these is better, BLAST or PsyBLAST? So this is a very vague question, so we're going to try and specify it a bit more. Specifically, we're going to try and benchmark these methods versus a gold standard. So what is benchmarking? Benchmarking is a process by which we try to test and validate a computational method, with the final goal being to decide which of them performs best. So here you see a small rock plot, or a receiver operator characteristic curve, in which we plot the true positive rate against the false positive rate for a whole bunch of different methods. Now, I won't go into the details on what these methods do, what they're trying to predict, how you calculate these true positive and false positive rates. There's a separate lecture on this slightly later on in the course. But the important thing to note here is that the blue curve at every stage lies above the red curve. Now you can quantify this difference with what we call the area under the curve, or the AUC, and you will also do this for the projects that you are working on this course. And the important takeaway from this is that the higher your AUC, the better your method performs. So this makes it possible to quantify the performance of your method, but what exactly is the question that you're trying to answer there? To do so, you first need to define what your method actually solves. So the algorithms we'll be talking about today produce sequence alignments, but we need to measure that very precisely, so we'll go into that in a bit. And perhaps more importantly is, do we have the correct answer? Do we know what they should have come up with? We call this a gold standard or a ground truth. And this is essential to be able to benchmark fairly, but it's also very difficult to come by. Because who decides if something is true or not? In some cases this can be done objectively, in some cases this is very difficult. Let you be the judge of which is more the case in your projects. So, what will we be talking about today? First of all, what is sequence alignment? We've seen this very small example of a multiple sequence alignment on the first slide, but can we quantify how similar sequences are? If we can, what does this tell us? Why would we even want to think about these things? And then most of this lecture will be filled by discussing the internals of four specific algorithms that we use for this. To start with, global alignment, which is roughly where it all began. Published by Neil and Wunsch, I think somewhere in the 1970s. An improvement on that was local alignment by Smith and Waterman in 1981. And then Altschul et al. Have published several papers on blasts and improvements thereupon, starting in the 90s and continuing today. So, what is sequence alignment? Simple exercise. I have two sequences on the board here. Can someone tell me how similar these are? Yes.
Does it depend on their position?
Yes, but these are not aligned yet, right? So we do not know, well, we can sort of see from a glance, but we haven't got a way to quantify how similar these are. And that's exactly the problem that I'm trying to steer at. So we have two sequences, and obviously the difference is that one has an extra A in the middle, right? Or is it that this one has a T where the A what used to be and lost the T at the end? Suppose that one of these sequences mutated into the other over the course of biology. Which of these explanations do you think is more likely? Yes?
The first one.
The first one. Okay, so you think the insertion of an A in this position is more likely than the substitution of an A to a T and the deletion of a T in the tail position?
Yeah, because the second has two changes.
I mean, correct.
It's different.
Right. So do we think that all of those changes are equally likely? Do we know if any of those changes are more likely than others? Not yet, right? So at the moment this is all based on assumption. But we can formalize those assumptions, and then within those assumptions we can state unequivocally that yes, the insertion is more likely than the substitution and deletion, so long as our assumptions hold. Right. So we've already started thinking about this now, but can we quantify how similar these sequences are? What do we need on top of the observation that they are different to come up with how similar are these in a number? Sorry?
The scoring method.
Yes, very good. I saw a finger in the back. Any input on what that scoring method might look like?
Putting some value in every insertion and deletion or replacement.
Very good. So what you're thinking of is the edit distance, right? Where we take a distance of unit one for either an insertion, a substitution, or a deletion. I hope the next line is on. That's close. It's close. Okay, so suppose that we were to score this with the edit distance, right? We see that in this given alignment, We have four matches, one mismatch, and one gap. What would the edit distance be here? If you have a matching sequence residue, would that infer a distance of one? Or would that be a distance of zero? Yes?
Yes, that was going to depend on how much penalty you'd be for each gap.
Yes, we'll get to more complex scoring functions in a bit. For now, the edit distance, very simple, is you add a distance point of one if you have a substitution, a distance point of one if you have an insertion, and a distance point of one if you have a deletion. So you do this for every position in your alignment. Right, so you have two sequences, and the position, or the residue in one position across the both of the sequences is one position in your alignment. So for this T, we have a distance of zero, for G, a distance of zero. This A is aligned against a gap, so this would be a distance of one. A is aligned against an A, distance of zero. T versus T is a distance of zero, and G versus T is again a substitution, so a distance of one. Across the entire sequence, we have now made two edits, which sums up to an edit distance of two. Okay, so more formally, we have a scoring function in which we sum over all aligned positions, and we calculate the match score, and we calculate a gap penalty. So this is actually a question: what if we change the values between a substitution and an insertion? This is where you can formally do that. Right, so if we have a match, we have a score of 0. If we have a mismatch, we have a minus score of 1. And if we have a gap, we have a minus score of 1 as well. Suppose we were to change this gap penalty to 3. What would then be the edit distance between these sequences? Right now, we've calculated it with a gap penalty of 1. We have one gap, so if we increase the gap penalty from 1 to 3, we end up with an edit distance of 4. It's not called an edit distance anymore at that point, but we'll get back to that in a second. Can everyone read this equation in the book? Can anyone not read it, perhaps, is the better question. Because I will happily explain it again if it is necessary for the same. Yes, I saw a couple of careful fingers. Okay, so what this says is, suppose you have an alignment of length n, and then for every index p, which is one position in that length n alignment, starting at 0 and ending at the last one, we calculate this and we sum it up. And then what comes out finally is our score. So the score is the sum of some function for every single position of the alignment. Now, what is this function? We take a scoring function for residue I at position P and residue J at position P, which come from the sequences I and J, so the first and the second sequence that we are aligned at position P in the alignment. And then either we get the match score there, or we subtract the gap penalty. Gap penalty, again, is what we assign introducing a gap instead of a substitution, and because we are using the identity scoring function here, you either get a 0 if you match, or a minus 1 if you don't match. Alright, moving on. This is basically what we just did by hand. We can make this far more complicated, and I won't bother you too much with the details, but this identity substitution that we assumed so far very quickly becomes irrelevant biological context. Instead, what we can do, for instance, is take the Blossom 62 matrix. So this tells you, for every amino acid that we know of aligned against any other amino acid, how likely is a substitution to occur in biology? I have a slightly different way of showing this as well. Here again, we have the amino acids on the x and the y axis, and then here the scores of substituting one for the other. Now, you may see that these scores are triangular, which means that everything in this blank half of the matrix is basically the mirror of this half. You might see some other interesting things. Specifically, that these amino acids can be grouped into blocks. And that within these blocks, the scores are relatively high, whereas outside of these blocks, they're relatively low. So, knowing what we know about substitution scores, a positive score, what does this mean here in the substitution matrix? It's already shown on the right hand of the slide. Can anyone explain what it means? Yes.
So these amino acids are probably most closer to the system. It's more likely to be the system.
Okay. Good start. Anyone else? What does a positive score tell me here? So yes, they are more conserved, and this probably has some functional relation, right? Because of homologous relationships. Yes.
And there's a high chance that they are
aligned. Very good. So if you're looking for the optimal alignment, your score gets a big bonus if these residues match up. Is there any residue in this list which has a higher score for a different amino acid than itself? Would it make sense if there were one? What would it mean if, for instance, aligning a cysteine against a cysteine has a lower score than aligning it against a proline? Yes? So, just in case someone didn't hear, in case it doesn't occur very often in a protein. Close, but not quite. This means that if we manually align sequences by what we think looks right, when lots of 62 matrix was generated, that it was observed that cysteine aligns against the proline more often than against itself. Which would be weird, right? So every amino acid's biggest score is aligned against itself. And then within these functional groups, there is sufficiently high scores for aligning against a sufficiently similar amino acid. In evolution, this would mean that substituting one amino acid for another doesn't alter the function of this residue so significantly that the protein no longer works. Right, so I've added some descriptions of what these residues have in common to help you start thinking about this, like alkylase, for example. Cysteine is against a cysteine, very important. Does anyone know why? I hear it? So the sulfide bridges, the disulfide bonds. These are very important to keep the structure or a protein together because these are covalent bonds and they really stabilize the structure of a protein. Right, so these amino acids in blue are all very small. What would happen if you were to substitute a small amino acid with one with a big aromatic ring? Yes? Somewhere in these very negative scores. Right? Because this breaks the structure that your protein is supposed to have. Same for negative and polar residues, these need to be grouped together. If you have a negative charge, say somewhere on the surface where your protein interacts with other proteins, you can suddenly have that switched around with positive charges, or even worse, hydrophobic residues. Right? And if you're a hydrophobe, so you're collapsed to the core, that means that it's more difficult to exchange you with, say, an aromatic residue or a very charged residue that is hydrophilic and wants to be at the surface of the protein. So, as an exercise, we can derive these by looking at manual alignments, but they also make sense from a biological point of view. Right? We can explain why some exchanges are more likely to result than others. Right. So there's also a way to make the gap penalties more complicated. I won't bother you with too much details on this, but there is such a thing called half-bind gap penalties. Discuss those in further depth next course. The idea is that opening a gap should be cheaper than extending it, because an insertion of three nucleotides at one go is cheaper, or is evolutionarily more likely, than an insertion of one nucleotide in one spot and two nucleotides in the other. Or in other words, this situation should be more likely than this situation. Exact language to do this, again, material for next course. Okay, so we have thought of ways that we can measure and express how similar two sequences are. Quickly to recap, what does it tell us if two sequences are very similar, and what does it tell us if they are not similar at all? It's already been mentioned before, yes?
There's a large chance that they're homologous.
Yes, and if we know two sequences are homologous, what does this tell us about the rest of, say, the proteins that these sequences have developed?
They have similar function.
They're very likely to have conserved function, conserved structure. Good. So, we have now these sequences and a way to score any possible alignment between them. What do we need to find this alignment? Now you might be overthinking this. Has anyone heard of the word algorithm? Can anyone explain to me what is an algorithm?
Just a sequence of steps.
Yes. Well, not necessarily iteratively, but yes, it is a sequence of steps. It is a set of instructions that you perform on a certain input, and that gives you a specified output. For global alignment and blast, I need you to think very carefully on what are the inputs and what are the outputs of the algorithm that we will discuss. That is exactly what we'll go into right now. So, algorithms in sequence alignment. We're going to start by talking about global alignment, because that's historically where we began. And I want you to specifically think of the number of possible alignments between any two sequences. So, as discussed, we have two sequences, a substitution matrix and a gap penalty, as the input for our alignment. And what do we want out? Of course, we want the alignment itself. And we want to know how good this alignment is. So this quantification that we've been hammering on since the first slide. Memorize this. If Jaap wakes you up at 3 in the morning and he asks input number and global alignment, this is what he wants to hear. So, finding the optimal alignment. We have here a whole bunch of output from the, I think, BLAST algorithm. This tells you a score, an expectation value, some parameterization of how exactly BLAST dealt with these inputs. But very importantly, it shows you here in the middle, the match lines, which gives you an indication of which of these positions are conserved, in turn, which of these positions might be homologous, and whether or not there is information about the second protein structure in the first protein structure or the respective functions. So the input for global alignment is two sequences, substitution matrix, gap penalty, the output is the alignment itself, and a score. How do we do this? Again, we have a bunch of input sequences. We use identity scoring again. For a match, you get plus one. For a mismatch, you get minus one. And for a gap penalty, we introduce two. So every time you have a gap instead of a mismatch, that costs you 2 points instead of one. Now, this is where it gets tricky. This is the scoring algorithm, and I'll show you how we use this in the next slide. We start with a matrix. In this matrix, we have sequence I on the y-axis and sequence j on the x-axis, and we have their respective indices, which is the length of the sequence, or which goes up to the length of the sequence. Now, for every cell in this matrix, there are three possible values you can pick in, you can fill in, and the one you actually fill in is the highest of those three. Which three values are they? They are the cell to your top left plus the substitution score, or the cell to your left plus the gap penalty, or the cell above you plus the gap penalty. Yes. So, to the top left, to the left, or to the top. What you do then is you calculate each of those three values and you pick the maximum as the very start of the function tells you. for the first row, this is very easy, right? You don't have a cell to your top, and you don't have a cell to your top left. So you must have come from the left, so you fill in the value to your left plus the gap penalty. In this case, minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, you see how this works. This is called initialization, because this is very easy in all the dynamic programming exercises that you'll soon see. So then for the next step, we start filling in the matrix itself. This is where it gets interesting. If we come from the top left, the value in that cell is 0, and the substitution score is a G against G is a match, so this is 1. 0 plus 1 adds up to a value of 1. Had we come from the top, it's minus 2 plus minus 2 would be minus 4. Same story from the left. So the highest value between 1, minus 4, and minus 4 is 1, so that's what we fill in this dynamic program matrix. You repeat this for every cell in this matrix, all the way until the bottom right cell. This is what it looks like. Now, if you've been clever about this, you've kept track of which cells you could have filled in these values from. Right? So for this one, we could have only come from the top left. I don't see an immediate example of where we could not have come from the top left. We'll get back to this in a bit. First question that we asked was, how can we quantify the alignment between these two sequences? Can anyone tell me how similar these two sequences are? Given the sequence alignment algorithm that we just performed, global alignment according to Neiman and Wish, what is the alignment score between sequence I and J? Yes?
Can you use the maximum score?
No. Anyone else? Yes.
2?
Why?
Because it's the highest score on the far side, far right side. All right.
Very good. So for global alignment, the alignment score is always in the bottom right cell. Now, you were saying that you want the maximum score in the entire matrix. That is for the local alignment. You were referring to the highest score in the last row in the last column. That's for semi-global alignment. There's a lot of terminology that doesn't make a lot of sense to most of you at this point yet, but it will after next course. We'll come back to algorithm sequence analysis, and we'll talk again after. But the important take-home is local alignment, global alignment, the alignment score is in the bottom right cell. All right, but now we want to know what actually is the alignment. So we have the score, how do these sequences line up best? This is how we can determine this matrix. This is the traceback step. So we have filled in our matrix, we have found the alignment score, and now we start walking back to the top left cell. Going only through those cells that could have given us the score that we filled in. So we can tell in the bottom right we have a score of 2, which was only which would only be possible by adding 1 to this value. Right? We allowed an A against an A, so we came from the top left, add 1. Tracing back, this means that we take this step. Now if you do this for all the cells in your matrix again, or at least all the ones starting from the bottom right, you end up taking either this path or this path. These are called the low row and the high row, respectively. And they tell you something about what the alignment looks like. In this case, there is at least 3 separate paths that each would have given you an alignment with a final score of 2. Now, tracing back with a low row algorithm would follow, as the name implies, the lowest row and give you exactly 1 answer. The high road algorithm would have produced this one, and some middle road algorithm you can conceive of might have found even this middle position. Can everyone see why these are the actual lines produced by these separate traceback routines? Can anyone walk me through the high row alignment step by step? Lightning volunteers, I will appoint one. the right cell, which cells could have given us this value? It's only the ones at the top left, right? Okay, so we align A against an A. This is the tail end of our line. Next step, this cell we are in now. Where did we come from to fill in A1 in this cell? Explain to me why there is a gap here if you go either vertical or horizontal. Okay, maybe start more reasoning. We know that these alignments or these input sequences have a different length, yes? So if we don't look at the scores at all, if we just go straight diagonally down, this is the cell we end up with. What have we now implicitly done? We have not aligned the last residue of this sequence. Right? So this A must then be aligned to a gap. In other words, we step up from the bottom right cell, we go up one, and then we align everything against each other. The way that this dynamic programming trick works is you break down the problem into smaller steps, the output of which are set in stone given the output of the previous ones. If you don't do this, you have to compare, what is it, n plus n squared, different possible alignments, which combinatorially explodes as your sequence lengths increase. In this case, we can do it in computational time of n times m. We'll get back to this in another slide. Okay, so we've seen now what happens when you fill out your dynamic programming matrix and you start tracing back to the bottom right cell. Suppose we have a high road algorithm implementation, but we wanted the low road alignment. Is there something simple we can do with our algorithm to reverse this without changing the actual code? Look at the table. Okay, so you want to change the trace back routine. That's cheating. You can't change the code.
You change the sequence.
Yes, that's exactly it. Right? So if you change the order in which you input the sequences, what you're effectively doing is you're transposing this table, and suddenly your high road algorithm finds the low road line. Simple trick, only playing with the inputs, not touching your code after it's input. Now, we briefly alluded to this. The time and memory complexity of dynamic programming is significantly faster than simply trying every possible alignment and scoring those individuals. Right? Because you can imagine that the brute force alternative to this is to write out every possible alignment between sequence I and J, perform the scoring function that we had before, summing over every position, and then picking the alignment with the highest score. Not only that, in this case, you would end up with three different alignments which have the exact same score after evaluating, 6 plus 7 is 13, 13 squared different alignments. Whereas you can do it much faster. 6 times 7, in this case. So not only does it save you a lot of time and complexity in calculations, you also don't need to store nearly as many results. Right? You don't need to make explicit every different alignment that's out there. You don't need to keep track of all the ones that score worse than the ones you've already calculated earlier in your dynamic programming matrix. So this really helps speed up alignment for larger sequences. Now you may know our genomes and our proteins contain billions of nucleotides and hundreds of amino acids. So this is an important improvement. So this is basically what we just mentioned briefly. Results in here only rely on what you've already calculated in here. So nothing you can do here changes what you've already filled in here. And that is, in large part, where it's speed up. Okay. Now, brief preview to local alignment, and then we're going to give you an exercise, a quick break. Local alignment was published by Smith and Waterman 11 years after global alignment. And I forget who, it's either Smith or Waterman, now was telling this story. They claim their biggest contribution to science was zero. This all makes sense in two slides. If you have global alignment, what do you think would happen if you were to align this sequence versus this sequence? Yes. Because they have the same amount of immunoglobulin domains, functional units, they have them in the same order, and even though this is a gorilla and this is a fruit fly, the order of these domains and the rough length of the sequence is fairly conserved. Now, if you were to look at the beta 2 microglobulin precursor in Bos Taurus, or the standard cow, you would see that they only have one immunoglobulin domain. Protein. So if you were to align this sequence against this one or this one, what do you think would happen? Yes? Why do you think you would get a very low score? Right. So, because there's a lot of gaps, because one sequence is so much shorter, this would artificially reduce the score that you give to your alignment. Fair point. It would also only be one of the I genome angles to align it against. Yes?
If you have like a large sequence with a smaller group, you don't go like the length at the same length here, but you just go like the length of the big one.
So for global alignment, every residue must be aligned. So if you're pointed against the gap, this constitutes scoring. If you're pointed against substitution, this constitutes scoring. So there is no freebies in global alignment. This is different from semi-global and, more importantly, local alignment, which is why we're discussing this right now. Right, but coming back to the earlier point, you would not get a very high score because there's so many gaps in alignment, even though there is at least three spots in this sequence that this one should match fairly nicely. Same point holds if you try to align this gorilla protein against this gorilla protein. This one has a domain which is not at all present in this one, but this one has two domains which are present in this one. So you would align this bit against this bit, and you get a huge negative score for everything that's not aligned because of gaps. There is a solution to this, but it does change the question that you're solving. You're no longer trying to find the best global alignment, but rather you're trying to find those pieces of sequence that match with a very high score locally. So this is roughly how you can visualize this. Suppose you were to take two of these sequences from the previous slide and make a global alignment between them. So you distribute this result and you plot the score of your alignment against the positions of your final trace map. So once you have your alignment, you plot the scores that this alignment had at different places in your scoring matrix. Now, looking at this, can you already tell me which parts align very well and which parts align rather poorly? Only this bottom graph, where you have the alignment position against the score of the alignment. Yes? So what about this graph tells you this? Right. So when your score is increasing, you have a bit of sequence that aligns well. When your score is decreasing, you have either gaps or poor substitution for things that don't align well. And then it goes back to increasing again, and finally it drops off. So which parts of this sequence do you think are actually homologous? Sorry, can you speak up?
Like it's going up.
Right. So, if you have a prolonged stretch of residues with increasing sequence alignment scores, that would tell you this lines up well. Is that what you were saying? Good. Then I completely agree. How could you change your algorithm so the way that we fill out our scoring matrix to not capture these huge deficits which end up with very negative scores and only look at these positive bits? What was the biggest contribution to science by either Smith or Waterman? Exactly. So by changing this dynamic programming function that we had before to also account for the presence of a zero, we completely changed the way in which the algorithm. What this says now is that whenever a gap or a substitution would put you at a score below zero, you fill in a zero instead. So whatever bits of your sequence align well, have a score that actually reflects how well they align. This also means that you are no longer trying to align your entire protein against itself, which has different consequences. But again, your algorithm depends on your question. So I won't bother you with how this actually works out in a dynamic programming matrix. You'll have plenty of time to practice that in period two. But for now, I do want to give you this quick exercise and then a couple of minutes to stretch your legs and come back fresh for half part two. So what I would like you to consider over the break is these two sequences, this scoring function, so the one with global alignment we treated earlier, with these substitutions, functions, and gap penalties. So, -1 for mismatch, +1 for match, -2 for gap.